is the school around vortices from continuum to quantum mechanics. And the first 3 days are dedicated to two mini courses, basic mini courses, one in fluid dynamics, the other one in the quantum part. So this morning we'll have the first of three lectures by Professor Evelyne Mio from Ecole Polytechnique, and she'll talk about vortex dynamics in fluids.
Okay, so thank you very much for the invitation and for giving me the opportunity to do a mini course here. So we start with a short presentation of the Euler and Navier-Stokes equations, and please don't hesitate to ask me questions if you don't understand. So, introduction. So I will present the Navier-Stokes and Euler. So this is not a good division for me. So I consider a fluid in two or three dimensions. So D is equal to two or three, and it denotes the dimension of the space. So I consider a fluid, incompressible fluid, on RD, and I denote by U . So this is a function defined on R plus times RD with values in RD. And this denotes the velocity of the fluid. And to describe the evolution of this incompressible fluid on RD, I use the following system of equation, which is dTu plus U gradient U is equal to the gradient of a pressure. And the divergence of U is equal to zero. So this corresponds to the incompressibility condition. P, as I said, it is a scalar quantity, so it is defined on R plus times RD with values in R. This is a pressure. What else? So yes, I should maybe write the dissipative part. So nu is a positive parameter. It is called the viscosity of the fluid. So if nu positive, strictly positive, then I get the Navier-Stokes equation. Which I call NS. And if nu is equal to zero, I get the Euler equation for incompressible fluids, which I call E. And actually I will focus on this Euler equation in this course, okay? So this sign corresponds to the Laplacian operator, and this is the gradient. So if you don't understand these notations, please ask me to define them, okay? So before giving some properties of this equation, I would like to insist on the connection between the Euler equation for incompressible perfect fluids and the Gross-Pitewski equation for superfluids. So if I consider superfluids like, for example, helium-2, they are described by a the wave function. A complex valued wave function. Which I denote by psi. So this from R times RD with values in C, psi of T and X. And the evolution of superfluids is described by this, the evolution of psi, by means of an equation which is called the Gross-Pitevsky equation. So this Gross-Pitevsky equation will appear next week in many talks, I guess. So it can be written as I dt psi plus Laplacian of psi plus psi times 1 minus the modulus of psi squared is equal to 0 on R times Rd. Okay? So this is my equation. And in fact, there is you can start from this equation to get the Euler equation by means of a transformation which is called the Madelung transform. So what is this Madelung transform? Assume that psi does not vanish. You can write it as psi of t and x is equal to the square root of rho of some function rho times exponential of a phase. Okay, so assume you can write it, you are allowed to write psi like this. Then, setting u is equal to 2 times the gradient of the phase, you get a system of equation for rho and u, which is like the Euler equation. And it's called the hydrodynamical form of the Gross-Pitevsky equation. So the first equation is an equation for rho. And the second equation is an equation for u. Plus gradient of 2 rho is equal to the gradient of a function of rho. Okay. So this additional term can be expressed explicitly in terms of rho, and it's called the Quantum pressure. And in particular, you see that if you take rho equals to 1, then you get the Euler equation. Okay. So this is, in fact, the compressible Euler equation with density rho. And if rho is equals to 1, you get Euler. So this is form. And in fact, you will see that thanks to this analogy between superfluids, yes? Okay, this is a function of rho. This is the Laplacian of square root of rho divided by square root of rho, something. You can express it explicitly in terms of rho. I can write it. So this is Laplacian of up to the sign. If rho is equal to 1, yes, you get no No pressure. Yes. Yes. This is formal, but yes. Exactly. And in fact, we will see that thanks to this analogy, in the regime of vortices, so for Euler or for Gross-Pitewski equation, rho is close to 1, except at some places, which correspond basically to the vortices, and we get the same motion law for the vortices. Yes?
Careful, you don't have incompressibility.
I get divergence of u is equals to 0 if rho is equals to 1. Yes.
So why did u equal 0?
Yes, Laplacian of phi is equal to, this is formal. So
this is,
no, it's not exactly Euler. But anyway, you can't. In fact, the good change of variables is not setting u is equals to the gradient of the phase, but setting u is equals to the supercurrent, which is defined, I will define it later.
Okay.
Okay. So this is a form of Euler. Yes? Okay. Okay, so now I will define a good quantity, a very important quantity, which is the vorticity. So for the moment, I come back to fluids. I come back to Euler or Navier-Stokes equation. And I define the vorticity to be a function omega. So from R plus times RD. So in fact, when D is equal to 2, it is a scalar quantity. And when D is equals to 3, it is a vector field. So to R3 if D equals 3. So we define it by omega is equal to D1 U2. So I have to check the sign because I never remember D1 U2, yes. U2 minus D2 U1 if D equals 2. And omega is the curl of u if d equals 3. Okay, so it is a scalar quantity in the two-dimensional case. And in fact, this quantity is a good one to describe the way in which the fluid rotates, okay, the small rotations in the fluid. And we have, we can derive from the Euler equation for u, or from the Navier-Stokes equation, an equation for the vorticity. And we will focus on the equation for the vorticity in the remainder of my talk, of my lectures. So we have the following proposition. So if D equals 2, the solution, so we assume that we have a smooth solution of the Euler equations, and then we get an equation for omega, which is dt omega plus u gradient omega equals to 0. And so it depends if we consider a solution of the Euler equation or of the Navier-Stokes equation, so I should put a Laplacian here in the general case. And if d equals 3, we get dt omega plus u gradient omega is equals to omega gradient u plus mu Laplacian omega. So this is if u solution of Navier-Stokes or Euler. Okay. So in particular, there is a strong difference between the two-dimensional case and the three-dimensional case. Okay? Because in the three-dimensional case, we get this additional term, which is called stretching term, and which will be responsible for many stretching effects for the vorticity. And which is responsible for the fact that we don't know whether or not there exists a global solution of the Euler equation, etc. Okay. In 3D. While in two dimensions, assume nu is equals to zero, then we get a nice equation for omega, which is a transport equation for omega. So please take care of this difference. And the proof to get this equation is simply take the curl of the equation for u. Okay. So exercise. Okay, so we have this quantity, omega, and we know that it is defined in terms of the velocity, to be the curl of the velocity. And now, since u is divergence-free, in fact, we can recover the velocity, in terms of the vorticity. In fact, we can invert the curl operator. So this is called the Biot-Savart law. This is my fourth point. So we want to invert the curl operator, okay, using the fact that u is divergence free. So in the following, we assume that u and omega are sufficiently smooth so that we can do all computations we want. So we assume that for some fixed time, so for each time, u of t is c infinity, and u of t x vanishes at infinity, and we assume that omega of t is compactly supported. To simplify things, okay? And we get the following proposition. Theorem. So this is the Biot-Savart law. So if I recall that omega is the vorticity, and that divergence of u of t is equal to zero. Okay. So if d equals two, we have u of t dot is the convolution of omega with the kernel k. So the convolution with respect to the x variable. Where k is defined to be 1 over 2 pi. X perp divided by x squared. So what is for x different from zero? What is x perp? X perp is simply you take the vector x and you let it rotate by a pi over 2 rotation. So x1, x2 perp is equal to minus x2. X1. Okay. This corresponds to this pi over 2 rotation. Like this. And in particular, k is a singular kernel. It is not defined when x equals to 0. Okay. So this is a two-dimensional case. And if d equals 3, then I get u of t is another convolution, so with another singular kernel, which I call N. Okay, and I write it like this to mean that, in fact, I take the product of N and omega of T. So let me explain what it means. That u of t and x will be given by the integral of n of x minus y cross product with omega of t and y dy over R3, where n of x is equal to minus 1 over 4 pi x over so this is my Biot-Savart law. So I will prove it for d equals 2, to simplify. So I compute the orthogonal gradient of omega. So there are many, many ways of proving this, but one of them is to compute, to consider the orthogonal gradient of omega. So by definition, so this is the definition I gave here. So this is minus d2 omega, d1 omega. So this is minus d2. So I remember that omega is given by d1 u2 minus d2 u1. And in fact, using that u is divergence free, I can express, I can say that d12 u2 is equal to minus d11 u1, and therefore I get the Laplacian of u, actually. So this is it, Laplacian u1. And therefore, introducing the fundamental solution of the Laplacian in R2, I can express u in terms of omega in the following way. So let g of x equals to 1 over 2 pi logarithm of the modulus of x. So this is a fundamental solution of the Laplacian in R2, in the sense that if I take the Laplacian, I get a Dirac mass at zero. Okay. So I know that the convolution of J with F, so if I take the convolution of J with X and the Laplacian of this, I get F. So therefore, I get that U is equal to J, so the convolution of J with the orthogonal gradient of omega, which I denote by this, plus a function which is harmonic. On R2. So now I can re-express this convolution. I can put the orthogonal gradient on J, G, sorry. So I get that u is equal to the orthogonal gradient of the fundamental solution, convolution with omega plus h. And now I realize that u tends to 0 at infinity. And this guy tends to 0 at infinity because I took omega compactly supported. And therefore, h is an harmonic function which tends to 0 at infinity. So it is 0. This is a Liouville theorem. H is equals to 0. Okay. And finally, I observe that K is actually equal to the Hungarian of G. So this is the end of the proof. And I get my Biot-Savart law. So in particular, from the proof, I see that U can be expressed as the orthogonal gradient of a scalar function, which is called the stream function. Remark one, in particular, U is the orthogonal gradient of psi. So this is not the solution of the Gross-Witalski equation. Nothing to do. So where psi is the convolution of G with omega. So in particular, the Laplacian of psi is equal to omega. And psi is called stream function. Okay. And the second remark, it's an important one. Is that in fact, okay, I assumed to do all my computations, I assumed from the beginning that U and omega are smooth, so that I can take the Laplacian, blah, blah, blah. But in fact, when I look at the Biot-Savart law in 2D, so this one, I realize that I don't need omega to be smooth in order to define the convolution of K with omega. I only need omega to be, for example, L infinity compactly supported. Okay, by use of Hölder's estimate, I can give sense to this convolution even if omega is not smooth. So the Biot-Savart law can be extended, or can be defined or considered, extended to omega of t, if you want, belonging to L infinity, compactly supported, or L1 or L1 n to L infinity, of RD, R2. Okay. And in this case, we get that U is uniformly bounded. And it's something more. It is almost Lipschitz. U of t, the L infinity norm of U of t is bounded by a constant which depends only on the norm of omega of t in L1 and in L infinity. So this is potential estimates. You take the convolution and you estimate everything. And U is almost Lipschitz. With respect to the x variable in the following sense. So for all x and y, u of tx minus u of ty is bounded by a constant, which depends on the norm of omega. Times x minus y times 1 plus the logarithm of x minus y. So if I don't have this logarithmic part, I get that u is a Lipschitz function. But I say that u is almost Lipschitz because I get this additional logarithmic part. Okay, but it's not that great. In fact, this kind of regularity is sufficient to define a flow map associated to u. So this is an important remark. So now I will speak about the flow trajectories. And from now on, I will consider a solution to the Euler equation. So I will not consider the Navier-Stokes equation anymore. Okay. So I consider Euler equation. I come to the second part. So I define, I assume that u here is a smooth solution. Euler in 2 or 3D. So by smooth, I mean so u of t, or u is c infinity. U of t, so this is what I said before. And omega compactly supported. I can possibly remove this this assumption on the support of omega. This is only to simplify the computations. So in particular, since omega of t is compactly supported, and assuming that the support is okay, and I should take u uniformly bounded. Plus times r d, okay, to simplify things. So given this kind of assumptions on u, I can define the flow map of u. So we define x. So this is a function from R plus times R D to R D. And so this satisfies the X over DT is equal to U of T, X of T and X, and X of 0, X equals to X, to R D. So by Cauchy-Lipschitz theorem, I know that given x, there exists a unique global solution of this ODE. So in fact, I don't need to consider a solution of the Euler equation to define this x, but since I'm dealing with the Euler equations, I assume from the beginning that u is a solution of Euler. So global solution. So, for all x belong to R0. Okay. And moreover, this so I call x the flow map, and moreover, it is invertible for all t. So this is the theorem. So for all, the first part of the theorem says that for all t, x of t preserves the Lebesgue measure on Rd. So what does it mean? I can write it like x of t, the push forward of x of t of the Lebesgue measure on Rd by x of t is equal to Ld. So which means that for all f belonging to L1, the integral of f of x of t and x is equal to the integral over Rd of f of x dx. Okay. So I preserve the volume. So the second part of the theorem says that depending on the dimension, if d equals 2, I have omega of t x of t x is equal to omega at time 0 x, while if d equals 3, I have omega equals to, so this is not equal to the initial vorticity. In fact, there is the stretching term, which is responsible to the fact that I have to multiply by the matrix gradient of x times omega 0 of x. So remember that omega 0 is a vector in R3, and I take I multiply this this vector by 3 times 3 matrix. Okay, so this makes sense. I have this stretching here. And therefore, if omega, if d equals 2, I can say that omega of t, so the measure, omega of t is the push forward of the initial vorticity by the flow x of t. So, the proof, all right, I will give a few ideas for the proof. So, in fact, to prove the first part of the theorem, when I perform a change of variable in this integral, so if I set y equals to x of t and x, I should get the determinant, the absolute value of the determinant of the gradient of x matrix. Okay. So in order to show that this is equal to this, I only have to show that the Jacobian of x equals to 1 for all time. So I set g of t and x equals to the determinant of x of t and x. So this is the Jacobian. Okay, and okay, I have that initially. Since the Jacobian matrix is equal to the identity initially, because x of 0, x is always equal to x, then j of 0, x is equal to 1. So I will show that the time derivative of j equals to 0, and therefore I will show that j equals 1. The Jacobian is equal to 1. Equal to 0. Okay. And in fact, we will show that dj over dt is equal to the divergence of u. And therefore, it is equal to 0. So when I say that the incompressibility condition reads divergence of u equals to 0, this means that the volume is preserved. Because in fact, the deformation of the volume is given precisely by Lauter. Sorry, or maybe it doesn't work. Okay. Sorry. Yes. Oh. Yes, I think it's one. Can you hear me? Okay. Oh yes. Sorry. Times J. No, it's here. Okay, sorry. Thank you. Okay, so to compute this, I won't compute it in detail, but the idea is to say that, so when I take the time derivative of J, so I have to compute the multilinear, so the differential of the determinant. Okay, times the time derivative of gradient x of tx. And since I deal with a C infinity solution, etc., when I take the gradient of this ODE, assuming that I can change the time derivative and the x derivative, I get that this is equal to gradient of u times gradient of x, of t and x. And this way I can compute this, and I can show that I will get the trace of the gradient of u, which is precisely the divergence of u. Okay. So this is the first part. The second part of the theorem so I just differentiate with respect to time the function omega of t x of t and x when d equals 2. I compute time derivative of omega of t x of t and x. So this is equal to dt omega plus x dot times the gradient of omega computed at the point t x of t and x. And using that x dot is precisely equal to u, I get dt omega plus u gradient omega, computed at the same point. And therefore, this is equal to 0. While when d equals 3, I get this additional term here corresponding to the stretching. So I will get gradient u times omega. And this is not equal to 0. So this is why omega is not constant along the flow trajectories. in the 3D case. Finally, for the third part, so the fact that omega is the push forward of the initial measure by the flow, this is only the first part, the combination of the first part and the second part. So this is a direct consequence of one and two. Two states that omega of t is the composition of omega of zero with x minus one. So the invert flow.
What is given and what you're trying to prove? That omega is a solution of Euler, or given omega is a solution of Euler,
I assume from
omega satisfies this relationship.
I assume from the beginning, so in the I wrote it in the just before defining x, I assume that omega or u is a solution, smooth solution of Euler. To D or 3D.
Therefore,
and I can define the flow, okay, associated to U, and necessarily I have these properties.
But then we need somehow the uniqueness in order to show that the only omega satisfies the relationship is exactly.
No. I just say that omega satisfies the transport equation, x is invertible. So I compute the time derivative of this and I show that this is equal to zero. So it is constant. I take a solution, and then it must satisfy this.
So the statement is that this is constant. That's what
yes, this is constant.
So that's the statement. Mm.
Omega of t, x of t and x is equal to omega of 0, x for all x. For all t, for all x. And the same holds for 3D. And therefore, since I know that the flow is invertible, I can express omega, I can invert this formula. And I can say that omega of t, x of x is equal to omega of 0, x minus 1 of x. Okay. Is it okay?
I just basically say what's the quantifier. Quantifying is that omega is constant. That's what it's saying.
Yes, the omega is constant along the flow trajectories. It must be constant. But I don't need any uniqueness to state this. Yes, I think it's time to speak about special solutions, the existence and uniqueness of solutions of the Euler equations. Because so far, I gave properties, assuming that I deal with a solution, then I must have this representation. So this is called the Lagrangian representation of the solution by means of flow trajectories. Okay, omega is constant along flow trajectories of the flow map associated to the velocity field. And now, I will give a few results concerning the existence and uniqueness of solutions. So this is the third part. Well, I will say some solutions. Some particular special solutions of the Euler equation. And in fact, I will deal with the two-dimensional case so far. And in the last course on Friday, I will consider solutions of the 3D Euler equations, or at least approximate solution of the 3D Euler equations. Okay? But now I deal with the 2D case. Restrict myself to the two-dimensional case. And I will start with classical solution or smooth solutions. And the result, which I'm not going to prove, is that so we assume that we take an initial condition U0 omega 0 belonging to C infinity, tending to 0 at infinity. Okay. Such that omega 0 is compactly supported and in infinity, then there exists a unique global solution which is smooth for all time. Such that, moreover, for all t, omega of t is compactly supported. So, in particular, this solution, this unique solution, okay, there exists a unique global solution such as corresponding to this initial condition. In particular, this unique solution, smooth, satisfies the previous representation formulas. So in particular, the vorticity is constant along the flow trajectories, etc., etc. Okay. And I said classical solution because the equation for omega or for u is satisfied in the classical sense because I can speak about the gradient, I can speak about the Laplacian, I can do everything. But now, if I want to deal with weaker solutions, I can define another class of solutions, which are weak solutions with bounded vorticity. Okay, so I need a definition. So I consider omega 0 belonging to L1 and to L infinity. Or you can ask for omega to be L infinity compactly supported. It depends on the definitions you take, but it's the same. Okay. And we say that U omega is a weak solution of Euler with this condition, with this initial condition. So we say on R plus, so if U equals K star omega, so I have this Biot-Savart representation, and for all phi compactly supported, okay, I can take, if you want, a distribution to simplify. For all T, I have this integral of phi of tx, omega of tx, dx. Okay. Minus phi of 0x, omega 0 of x. dx is equal to the integral from 0 to t of the integral of omega times dt phi plus u gradient phi dx ds. Okay. So everything makes sense in this formulation, provided that omega is assumed to be uniformly bounded and in L1. Because as I said, when I define from this kind of omega, I define u via the Biot-Savart law, then u is uniformly bounded, and therefore the product omega times u belongs to L1 lock. And therefore I can give sense to the product omega u times gradient phi, when phi is compactly supported. Okay? So this is my weak formulation, and we will see maybe tomorrow another kind of weak formulation when omega is not bounded, and not even in L1, but this is another story. And you can remark that if omega is a weak solution, and if moreover omega is C1, or smooth, then you can perform an integration by part here, and you retrieve the formulation for the vorticity, which I gave before. So this is a formulation which is consistent with the equation for classical solutions. So in fact, it is weakly continuous in time with values in the space of measures, thanks to this definition. Okay. So in fact, I should assume that omega is a weakly omega is weakly continuous in time with values in the space of measure, or with value or dt omega is bounded in negative Sobolev spaces, for example. In order to be able to define phi of omega of t for all time. Yes, you're right. So if omega is okay. So weakly continuous with values in the space of measures. Okay. So this is weak star continuity with values in the space of measures, which means that for omega, the function, the integral of omega of t phi of x is continuous for all phi belonging to C0, for example. And this is a way of giving a sense to omega of t for all time. Yes. So, in fact, the point is that assuming that you can give sense to omega of t for all t, then you get the weak continuity, of course. But the point is that before writing this, I have to have the right to define omega of t.
Yes, but you can integrate from
here to another. Yes, you can get rid of this condition by saying that I get rid of this part, and I say that for all compactly supported function, minus this integral is equal to the integral on R. Yes. This is and then you will get the weak continuity. And the theorem, which was proved by Yudovich in the 60s, which I never remember if there is a T or not, is the following. So there exists, so for all omega 0 belonging to L1 to L infinity, there exists a unique weak solution with this initial condition. And in fact, this unique weak global weak solution of the Euler equation is quite strong in the sense that, as I said, the velocity is almost Lipschitz. So we can still define the flow trajectories. And we still have the representation I wrote before. So we still have that omega is constant along the characteristics. Okay. So we have another, and I'm going slowly towards the vortex model. So we have stationary solutions. So we look, so I'm going to do some computations because we look for stationary solutions. Not stationary solutions. So we look actually for radially symmetric smooth solutions. Smooth solutions. So when I say radially symmetric, I'm talking about omega. So I look for a solution omega which is radially symmetric. So this means that omega of t and x can be written as a function omega bar of t times and the modulus of x. Okay. So we assume that I have this. Then how should omega bar look like? Then the stream function should be also radially symmetric because it satisfies Laplacian of psi equals to omega bar to omega. So then I have psi of t and x equals to a function which I denote by psi bar of t times modulus of x. And therefore, the velocity satisfies. So it is the orthogonal gradient of psi, remember? So when I take the orthogonal gradient of this, I should get x prop over the modulus of x times the psi bar over the r, okay, which means that the velocity field is azimuthal and gradient omega is radial. So this is the omega bar over the r. Okay. So in particular, u times gradient omega equals to zero. So if I want omega to be a solution, I must have dt omega equals to zero. So radially symmetric solution has to be stationary. Okay. And then I try to solve my to find my profile, omega bar. So since the Laplacian of psi bar psi equals to omega, so this means that in radial coordinates, I get this. To omega bar. Okay. R denotes the modulus of x. So I can integrate this equation, okay, and I get that psi prime is equal to 1 over psi prime of r is equal to 1 over r times the integral from 0 to r of s omega bar of s ds. And therefore, u of x will be given by x prop over x squared times integral from 0 to x of s omega bar of s ds. Okay. And in particular, when I compute the flow trajectories, since the velocity field is azimuthal, then the trajectories are circles. since so this is equal to x times u of t x of t x. Then this is equal to zero. The trajectory is. What could I say? In particular, if the support of omega bar is a ball of radius 1, let's say, then I get that u of x is equal to x perp. Is equal to x perp over x squared times 2 times the integral of omega for x larger than 1. Okay, from this formula. So, in particular, if I assume that the integral of omega equals to 0, then u vanishes away from the ball of radius 1. How does it look like first? It's a velocity field, which is, so this is u, I have this, zero. And this is a field which is orthogonal to x, okay, and which can possibly grow, okay, no, it won't grow, but it tends to zero at infinity. So in fact, so this is in the radial coordinates. But when I, so this is a function which is defined on R. But when I translate, this is actually the integral on the ball of radius x of omega. Because I times 2 pi, 1 over 2 pi. Because I can change variables here. So it depends on if you consider the integral of omega bar or the integral of omega. Okay. No, I don't know if I understood well your question. Okay.
My confusion is the integral on the right hand side is double integral of omega, but the integral on the left hand side is respect to r. Is that correct?
Sorry, this is integral on of the function omega bar, which is a function defined on R. Okay? But I say that omega of x is omega bar of the modulus of x. So if I change variable and if I get an integral on R2, this is precisely up to a 2 pi factor, the integral of omega on a ball of radius x. Okay? So this is the integral of omega. Yes.
Well, the first integral is not double integral. That's exactly my point. So
yes, but wait. But omega is radial.
I understand. Just basically clarifying notation.
But
right hand side, the integral is double integral, while the left hand side is integral.
When I speak about omega, this is a function defined on R2. When I speak about omega bar, this is a function defined on R. So if I take the integral of omega bar, this means this is implicitly said that this is an integral on R. Okay, so this is the integral, one-dimensional integral. And this is the integral on R2.
That's what I said, double
integral. Oh, okay, yes. But I never put two integrals.
Yes.
So, yes, sometimes I write omega bar and sometimes I write omega. Okay. So, in particular, so I take omega such that the integral of omega on R2 equals to zero, and the support of omega is included in a ball of radius 1, let's say, then u of x equals to zero if x is larger than 1. So I get, I don't see anything away from off the ball of radius 1, and this is what we call a phantom vortex. Okay. So now I'm going slowly towards the point vortex model, high time. Okay, I get finally another class of solutions, are called vortex patch models. So a vortex patch is is when the vorticity is constant on a set. So if omega zero is a characteristic function on the set omega zero, then omega at time t will be the characteristic function on another set, omega of t, where, thanks to the previous representation, omega of t is given by x of t, omega zero. Okay. And you can put, if you want, a gamma here, which is called the intensity of the vortex patch. Okay. But the form, the shape of omega will change when time evolves. But the volume is preserved. The measure of omega of t will be constant. So I assume that, so I will consider a specific stationary solution, omega epsilon of x equals to 1 over pi epsilon squared times the characteristic function on a ball centered at zero and of radius epsilon. Okay. And I take epsilon small. Okay. So in particular, this is a stationary solution because it is you can even take 1 over epsilon squared. Hence rho of x over epsilon with rho radially symmetric, and rho positive, and the integral of rho equals to 1. So this defines a stationary solution. With the corresponding velocity field given by, thanks to the formula over there, u epsilon of x equals to x squared over 2 pi x squared if x larger than epsilon. Okay, I just have to come back to the previous formula. And this is equal to x perp over 2 pi epsilon squared if smaller than epsilon. Okay. So this is my velocity field. Okay. And in particular, when epsilon goes to zero, what do I get? So the omega epsilon of x will converge in some sense to a Dirac mass at point zero. Converges towards, okay. I will put some gamma here. Where gamma is real. So omega epsilon will converge to some gamma delta zero. So in the weak star, a weakly star in the sense of measures. And u epsilon converges to u star of x, where the velocity field u star is simply x squared divided by 2 pi x squared. So the convergence for the velocity field holds locally uniformly away from zero, okay, on compact sets away from zero. Okay, so this is a prototype of a vortex. U star will be like this, and it becomes very large when the modulus of x becomes small, okay? And the limiting vorticity of omega epsilon is just a Dirac mass, so I can't write it on the blackboard. Okay, so this is a prototype. And now, what we would like to do is to consider initial vorticities that are given by a superposition of several vortices. So I have the following question. Question. Assume that I start with omega epsilon zero of x. My initial vorticity is given by the superposition of L vortices of intensities gamma I. Okay, so this is the circulation of the intensity of the point vortex times characteristic function on a ball centered at the point ZI zero. Take the superposition of several vortices. So this converges in the weak sense of measures to a sum of Dirac masses. Okay. So this is a vorticity for all positive epsilon. This vorticity belongs to L1 and to L infinity. It is even compactly supported. So it belongs to L infinity, compactly supported. Okay, so by Yudovich theorem, I know that there exists a unique corresponding global solution. Okay. So I consider omega epsilon of T and X the unique Yudovich solution. Okay. And my question is, does omega epsilon of T and X converge to some sum of Dirac masses? Okay. And if yes, where are the point vortices? Okay. where are they? So I have two different problems. One is to prove that at positive times, I still have some kind of localization for my vorticity, so it's still concentrated around points. And then I have to determine the motion law of the points. And in fact, this is true. Theorem. So this was proved by different authors, Marcuro Pulvirenti in the 90s, and Turkington, and I think Serfati proved it also. So I will only state a non-precise theorem, but the theorem says essentially that this holds true. For all time strictly smaller than some t star, where the points, the I of t, are a solution of a system of ODEs, so they satisfy the I dot of t equals to the sum for j different from a of gamma j k of Zi minus Cj, Zi of 0 equals to Zi 0, and T star is the maximal time of existence of this system. This system will be denoted by star. So I'm not writing all assumptions to get this convergence, but essentially for this kind of initial vorticities, so when I take a sum of vortex patches, I really get this convergence here towards the solution of the point vortex system. So this system of ODEs is called the point vortex system. So I will only explain to you how we can get formally this system of equations from the Euler equations. Okay? But this is formal. So we assume that the representation omega of t. So if I say, I call this omega zero, this is a measure, and I assume that omega zero can be evolved according to the Euler equations in some sense. In the following sense, in fact. So omega of t is the push forward of omega zero by the flow of u. Okay? So therefore, it must be a sum of direct masses at the points zi of zero. So the image of the points zi zero by the flow x of t. And now I assume that I still have a Biot-Savart formula to describe my velocity field. So when I assume that omega is the sum of direct masses, so if I call, okay. So setting the I of t equals to x of t, the I zero, then u of t and x is equal to the sum. So this is the convolution of k with omega, so this is the sum. Gamma j k of x minus cj of t, because I take the convolution of k with the sum of direct masses at the points cj of t. Okay, and therefore, if I compute u of t zi of t, okay, we have zi dot of t equals to u of t, zi of t. Okay. So I have to compute u of t, zi of t. So this is the sum of gamma j, k of zi of t minus j of t. Oops, but I have to take j different from I, because otherwise the kernel would not be defined. So this is the main approximation. I assume that the velocity field computed, created by a point vortex is equal to zero at the point vortex. And in fact, this can be justified here. For example, when you see a point vortex to be the limit of this kind of vortex patches, when you compute the corresponding velocity field at the point zero, at the direct mass, this is equal to zero by symmetry. Okay. So this can be justified rigorously, and in fact, this is a matter of the theorem of Marcureau and Pulvirenti. So this is how we get the motion law for the point vortices. So I still have a few minutes, maybe. So I just wanted to mention other point vortex dynamics in related equations. So for example, in the Navier-Stokes equation, because it will appear next week in Wayne's series of lectures, so he will talk about the Ozin vortices. So for the Navier-Stokes equation in 2D, the radially symmetric solutions are not stationary. In fact, they are self-similar. So there is a class of solutions, a special class of solutions, which is called the Ozen vortex. So it is given by omega nu of t and x equals to 1 over square root of... okay, I never remember if there is a square root or not. No. There isn't any. So this is for the velocity. So you have a profile j of x over square root of nu t. So I recall that nu denotes the viscosity. Okay. So j g is a profile. So it is a Gaussian. Maybe there is a renormalization factor. For pi, yes. And the corresponding velocity field is given by gamma over square root of nu t times a profile of x over square root of nu t. the profile is given by psi curve over psi squared times 2 pi times 1 minus exponential of minus psi squared over 4. So in particular, when psi is small, this corresponds, you retrieve, when psi is large, sorry, you retrieve the velocity field associated to a vortex for the Euler equations. And you see that when the viscosity tends to zero, which corresponds to approximating taking the limit from Navier-Stokes to the Euler equation, this converges to Dirac mass. Omega nu converges to gamma delta zero. And u nu converges to u star. Okay? And in fact, the derivation of the point vortex dynamics in the inviscid limit was performed by Thierry Gallet, in particular, for the Navier-Stokes equation. And there is another related equation, which is called the... okay, so this is the Gross-Pitewski equation. So you take a different scaling for the Gross-Pitewski equation. You consider this scaling, so I dt psi epsilon plus Laplacian of psi epsilon, okay, in 2D, plus psi epsilon divided by epsilon squared times 1 minus psi epsilon squared equals to 0. Okay. And you define... So epsilon goes to zero, which means that the modulus of psi epsilon should converge to one. Okay. And in fact, in some regimes, you can define the vorticity associated to the Gross-Pitewski equation. We define the supercurrent. So I think this afternoon we will have an insight into this kind of stuff, but this was just to mention the connection. So this is the cross product of psi epsilon with the gradient of psi epsilon. And in fact, this is precisely psi epsilon squared times the gradient of the phase, if you can write psi epsilon as psi epsilon times exponential of phi epsilon. Okay. So this makes sense even if the modulus of psi epsilon vanishes. Okay, so I can always define this supercurrent, and this plays the role of the velocity in the analogy between fluids and superfluids. And I define, so this plays the role of the velocity. Okay. And associated to this velocity, I can define the vorticity as the curl of the velocity. So this is one half, in fact, we define it to be one half of the curl of the velocity. And then I get an equation for this vorticity, which is very close, very similar to the equation for omega in fluids. I get that the vorticity get something like this, in fact. Okay. This is an equation, but in fact, compare it with dt omega plus curl d of u tensor product with u for Euler. this corresponds to U gradient U, in fact. Okay. So I get a similar equation. And the theorem, which was proved by many authors, Colliander, Gérard, Lin and Zin, Petrel, etc. Gérard, and Gérard Smith. Okay, I won't mention everybody, but still. The theorem says that if you start with a vorticity, which is concentrated, which concentrates at some points, so you take a sequence of initial condition, C epsilon zero, which converges in the sense of distributions, not in the weak sense of measures, towards a sum of delta Ci zero. Pi is 314. It's sorry. Pi is it's a number of 314, etc. No, no, it's a small pi. Yes, because it's a. Oh, okay, okay. I will let it like this. Usually, we put a pi, but it depends on the intensities. Okay, but we put a pi. And I take gamma I equals to plus or minus 1. So this is why this is important to put pi, okay? Because the degrees of the vortices are quantified. In this sense, plus other assumptions that I'm not going to write, that are called well-preparedness assumptions, okay? Then, for all t smaller than t star, we have j of psi epsilon of t converges or concentrates towards gamma I delta ci of t with ci solution of the point vortex model, okay, up to a factor, up to a constant factor. So maybe you have to change k into 4k, something like this. But what is important is that you get the same kind of dynamics for the point vortices, for the Gross-Pitevsky equations. And here the convergence holds in the sense of distribution. So you can weaken this assumption, but this is true. Okay, so I think I will stop here for today. Thank you very much for your attention.